In a troubleshooting situation, some knowledge of how a typical switching transistor circuit is constructed is required. In fact, you may even need to construct such a circuit under certain circumstances. So, in order to get the total picture, we'll construct a transistor switching circuit from scratch. Working step by step, we'll design a driver circuit for a standard light-emitting diode. The LED is rated at 1.6 volts with 20 milliamps of current. The LED is the load on our transistor. This load drops 1.6 volts and requires 20 milliamps of current for operation, and so the load is defined. Next, VCC is defined. Because the LED requires only 1.6 volts for operation, we can use a plus 5 volt power supply. Next, we need to select an appropriate switching transistor. For the moment, let's assume we'll use the 2N3904 we've already examined and sketch a driver circuit that looks like this. But in order to determine whether or not the 2N3904 is adequate for this application, we need to check the four critical specifications: maximum breakdown voltage, maximum collector current, switching time, and beta. Reviewing its specifications, we know that the 2N3904 has a breakdown voltage listed at 40 volts DC. Its collector current is rated at 200 milliamps. Switching time is limited to pulses greater than 250 nanoseconds because of its slow turnoff time. Let's assume that the input pulse width to this circuit we are designing is greater than 250 nanoseconds. And finally, it has a beta range from 100 to 300. With the data we now have, is this device adequate for this application? Our circuit uses only 5 volts. With 40 volts maximum DC breakdown voltage, we have 35 volts for a margin of safety. Our circuit requires merely 20 milliamps, while the maximum collector current of the device is rated at 200 milliamps, allowing a safety margin of 180 milliamps. We've already assumed that the switching time is adequate. With a beta range from 100 to 300, we've exceeded the bottom line beta. Clearly, this device is more than adequate for this application. We know that the current needed by the LED is 20 milliamps, and we'll specify the collector current to be 20 milliamps. Looking at this circuit in the cutoff state, base emitter voltage equals zero, base current stops flowing, therefore collector current stops flowing, and the LED is dark. Switching to the on or saturation state, the situation is very different. When the base is driven by the input signal, base emitter voltage will be 0.7 volts. A large base current will flow as a result. When base current flows, collector current flows, the device saturates, and the LED is bright. At saturation, the 5 volts VCC supply voltage is distributed in the output circuit in this manner. 0.2 volts is dropped across the collector emitter, and 1.6 volts is dropped across the LED. Then what should the collector resistor's voltage drop be? The collector resistor's voltage drop equals the power supply voltage minus the LED voltage drop and the collector emitter voltage drop. Given the values we have, we can see that the collector resistor should drop 3.2 volts, and all voltage is accounted for. Keeping in mind that the collector current must be 20 milliamps in order to activate the LED, we can find the collector resistor's ohmic value with the use of Ohm's law. Collector resistor value is equal to VRC divided by the collector current, IC. 3.2 volts divided by 20 milliamps equals 160 ohms. We can use a standard 150 ohm resistor with a 10% tolerance. Now, let's take a look at the input. The input signal is the output of a logic circuit with an amplitude of 0 volts as its low and plus 5 volts as its high. Again, when input voltage is zero, a low, this NPN device is in cutoff. When plus 5 volts, a high, is applied, the device saturates. Only 0.7 volts are needed to forward bias the base emitter junction, which means Vin at 5 volts minus 0.7 volts for VBE equals 4.3 volts of excess voltage. When 5 volts is applied at the input, the base resistor must drop this 4.3 volts. Now we need to find the base current. For this, we use the formula we discussed earlier. Collector current equals beta times base current. Solving for the base current equals collector current divided by beta. All of this is pretty straightforward. However, there is one rule of thumb to note. Good practice requires that we double the collector current when calculating the base current. This is so we can be sure that adequate base current flows in the transistor to properly saturate it. By doubling the collector current, we can take into account any device variation in beta. And so, base current equals 2 times collector current divided by beta, or in this circuit, 2 times 20 milliamps divided by 100 equals 400 microamps. We can use Ohm's law to find the ohmic value of the base resistor. RB is equal to VRB divided by IB. 4.3 volts divided by 400 microamps equals 10,750 ohms. This means we can use a standard 10K ohm resistor with a tolerance of 10%. This then is our final circuit with RB at 10K ohms and RC at 150 ohms. And so, by applying the operating principles of the switching transistor to build a typical switching circuit, we can see how such a critical device is employed in digital circuits.